Hello friends, I am Anuradha Kadam and today we are going to see 10th science 6th chapter life processes. So first we need to see to whom we can say a lie. So criteria to decide whether something is a lie or not. The most important criteria to decide whether something is alive is movement. All living things without the help of any external help. Is every living organism is moving without the help of external help. Some movements are easily visible, like the movement of a body parts. Means when you see the march past, so they are moving, their movement is in one direction, so it is very easily visible or it is very easily identical. Some movements are not easily visible, like molecular movements. The molecular movement in cells and tissue is necessary for all life processes. Means see, just see the pictures in this board. Means birds are flying. In the next, you can see the fishes are moving. So these are the visible movements. So many examples you can give. Whenever we are walking, whenever we are talking with expressions. So all these things by which we are getting that something is alive. But can we identify how our respiration is process is going inside our body? Means, suppose we are sleeping, at that time also our stomach is moving up and down. Our chest is moving up and down. So this movement shows that something is alive. But some molecular movements in cell, we are not able to identify that they are, that particular cell is alive or not, or that particular tissues are alive or not. So what is exactly mean the life processes? How we can identify these life processes? So see, life processes are the basic processes in living organisms which are necessary for maintaining their life. The basic life processes are nutrition, respiration, transportation and excretion. So one by one we will see nutrition. So see, the nutrition is the process of taking food by an organism and its utilization by the body for life processes. Life processes, in the life processes, the nutrition means intake of food is a very important process. Then respiration is the process by which food is burned in the cells of the body with the help of oxygen to release energy. You are aware that in respiration process, the oxygen is used to release the energy. Then transportation, it is the process by which food, oxygen, water, waste products are carried out from one part of our body to the others. And fourth, excretion. In excretion process by which the waste products are removed from our body. So you just see the diagrams. So first is the digestive system. You are aware how whenever we are intaking the food, it is not enough. It should be digested in a proper way. And undigested food also should be removed from our body. That we are going to see in the excretion process, how the toxic chemicals or how the toxic products get removed from our body. The next, respiration, you are aware, in the respiration process the energy is get created from the carbohydrates. Next, transportation. You are aware each and every food atom or the blood should be passed from one part of our body to others. Means in lungs the blood is get oxygenated, but from the lungs it should pass to all our body, and from all our body the deoxygenated blood should come into lung for oxygenation, and this work is done with the transportation process. So in this way, the nutrition, respiration, transportation and excretion are the basic processes in living organism and which are very necessary for maintaining their lives. See, one by one we will see now what is mean by nutrition, how this process will work. See, nutrition is the process of taking food by an organism and its utilization by the body to build the body for growth, to repair the damaged parts of the body, and for energy. Life on earth depends on carbon-based molecules, and most of the food are also carbon-based molecules. The outside raw materials used by living organisms are food, water and air. Now we will see the modes of nutrition. So there are two main modes of nutrition. They are autotrophic nutrition and heterotrophic nutrition. Autotrophic nutrition is the mode of nutrition in which organisms prepare their own food from simple inorganic substances like carbon dioxide and water in the presence of sunlight and chlorophyll. You are aware the photosynthesis process. And yes, all the green plants and some of the bacteria are only able to make their own food. Second one is a heterotrophic nutrition. It is the nutrition in which organisms get their food directly or indirectly from the plants. All living organisms are most of heterotrophic except the plants. So we can say examples like all animals, fungi and some bacteria also. If we consider the types of heterotrophic nutrition, so there are again three main types of heterotrophic nutrition. They are the saprotrophic, parasitic and holozoic nutrition. So one by one we will see. Saprotrophic nutrition is the nutrition in which organisms get their food from dead and decaying organisms. They break down the food material outside their body and then absorbs it. For example, mushrooms, bread molds, yeast and some bacteria. The next one, parasitic nutrition. So parasitic nutrition is the nutrition in which the organisms get their food from living organisms, means the host, without killing them. You are aware the cascucha plant, so they are climbing over the host plant and they are taking the food prepared by that host plant. And in this way, actually the host is get deprived from the nutrition. The third one is the holozoic nutrition. It is the nutrition in which organism take food directly and then digest and absorbs it. Like amoeba, paramecium, some birds, fishes and humans also. As plants are living organism, they also require the food, but they are able to prepare their own food with the help of carbon dioxide, water, sunlight and chlorophyll. So we'll just see the nutrition in plants. Plants are preparing their food by the photosynthesis process. Photosynthesis process is the process by which plants prepare food by using carbon dioxide and water in the presence of sunlight and chlorophyll. The food prepared is carbohydrates, which is stored in the form of starch. And in this process, oxygen is released. Just we will see the equation of photosynthesis. So 6CO2 plus 12H2O in the presence of sunlight and chlorophyll, it gives C6H12O6 plus 6H2O plus 6O2. This carbon dioxide plus water in the presence of sunlight and chlorophyll gives glucose, water and oxygen. We'll just discuss the process of photosynthesis. So photosynthesis takes place in three main steps, and they are: the first, absorption of light from the chlorophyll. You are aware light energy is absorbed by the chlorophyll, which is present in the leaf. Chlorophyll having green in color, and chlorophyll absorbs the sun heat from the heat from the sun light. Then in the second step, this absorbed light energy is get changed into chemical energy, and it starts to splitting up of water molecules into hydrogen and oxygen. When this water molecule is get splitted in the hydrogen and oxygen in the third step by reduction of carbon dioxide by hydrogen to form the carbohydrates. So just see here the photosynthesis process. See how they are getting water. They are getting water from the roots. They are getting, the leaves are getting carbon dioxide from the air and energy from the sun light. Chlorophyll, which is green in color, which gives green color to the leaves, they are present in the leaves themselves. And in this process, they releases the oxygen, which is very important for other living organisms. Now see exactly work of a chlorophyll and its structure. See, the chlorophyll are the green pigments present in the leaves. If we observe across a section of a leaf under a microscope, we can see cells containing the green dot-like structures called as chloroplasts, which contain the chlorophyll. Here in the diagram, you can see how these guard cells with the chloroplast are present. And just see how from the stomatas are the openings, small openings, and from that carbon dioxide as well as oxygen is moving inside and outside the leaves or the cells. So the stomata are always protected by the guard cells, and due to the pressure, water pressure, they get open. Where there is a high water vapor content, from that the low outside, if there is a low water vapor content, so stomata is get open. Okay. In this way, stomata when open, it allow the carbon dioxide to enter and water vapors to leave. See, this is the exactly the diagram how the stomatas are there. See, the chloroplasts are present. It get divided into upper epidermis, mesophyll, and the lower epidermis. See the air space. This air space gives pressure on the inner surface of the stomatas, and by which it will get open or it will get closed. See the diagram. In this diagram, you just get the chloroplast, which contain the chlorophyll. So just we will discuss one point, that all leaves are having green color, but some are not. What is the reason? As a chloroplast, which contain the chlorophyll, which gives color to the leaves. As chlorophyll has a green color, all leaves are mostly in a green color. So what about the leaves which is having the different color? Means some leaves are with the red color, some leaves are with the yellow color. That doesn't contain the chlorophyll. No, they also contain the chlorophyll, but the other color is get wrapped with the means different color. This chloroplast is get wrapped with suppose red color, so the leaves are having red color, but yes, they contain the chlorophyll by which they are able to prepare their own food. Now see how stomata open to allow the carbon dioxide to enter a leaf and a water vapor to leave. As you see in a diagram, there is a high water vapor content. So when there is a change in the high water vapor content inside the cells, and outside there is a low water vapor content. So because of the difference in the this low water vapor and high water vapor content, so the water vapors starts to come out of the stomata, and carbon dioxide, when there is a low carbon dioxide inside the cell, so and accordingly means when there is a difference in the concentration inside and outside, if the outside inside carbon dioxide concentration is low and outside carbon dioxide concentration is high, then from the outside means from higher to lower, it will starts to flow. So as inner carbon dioxide concentration is very low and outside of the leaf there is a high carbon dioxide content, so carbon dioxide enter in the leaves through stomata. Now we will discuss about stomata. So stomata are a tiny pores present in the leaves through which exchange of gases takes place. Each stomata has a pair of guard cells which control the opening and closing of the stomatal pore. When water enters the guard cell, it swells and the pore opens, and when the guard cell loses water, it shrinks and the pore closes. So in this diagram, you can see how these stomata are open and closed. Actually, each stomata contain the pair of guard cells. Means two guard cells are there. Actually, these guard cells are controlling the opening and closing of the stomata. See, this is the diagram of the guard cells, and here you can identify some stomata are open and some are closed. See the exactly work of the guard cell, how they releases water and mistake carbon dioxide. Just see the guard cells, which two guard cells are present, and how the water diffuses into the guard cells, which causes them to open. And hot and dry days, the guard cells have less water, they relax and stomata close. So this is the activity which shows that chlorophyll is necessary for photosynthesis. A simple activity, you can do it at your home also. Just take a potted plant having the variegated leaves.